Thank you for coming this afternoon. We're going to be looking at the topic that you can read. One of the things about this whole subject of knowing the exact wording of Scripture and doctrine of the inspiration of Scripture is this is an area where Christians recently have been using some of their very worst theological vocabulary. Let me explain. Often we talk about the original text. We go and we believe in the original text. The only problem is that our word text is ambiguous. It's polyvalent. It's got more than one meaning. Text we might use just for words, wording. We might also use it for a physical object. We might say, I have a text in my hand and it weighs 25 grams. Right? You understand the difference. So we use text for manuscript, physical copy, and for the words on the manuscript. So when we say we're interested in the original text, what are we actually interested in? I would say we're not interested in the original physical object. I mean, we can be a bit interested in it, but that's not our main interest. When God spoke and said, in the beginning was the word, that sequence of words is what he spoke. And it's given by him before it gets written onto the manuscript. And if you copy it from a manuscript to another manuscript, it doesn't become less from God. And if you copy the manuscript from there into your mind, your neurons and synapses and wherever we keep things in our mind, it doesn't become less from God. If you transfer it to sound waves or to bytes, if you transfer it to a different medium, it doesn't become less from God, because God's word is indestructible. So when we say we believe in the Bible in its original text, and someone says, but you don't have the original text, they were lost all those years ago, you realize we've used a word which is multivalent, and as a result we've created confusion. So text comes from, into English, I think from French text, which comes from late Latin textus, which means the texture of verbs, the web of words. So really, we should be talking about the original wording. We often say, but we believe in the original manuscripts. But again, did God breathe into papyrus? Did he breathe into leather? Or did he speak words which were then written on papyrus and leather? You see, God spoke words. We believe God spoke. That's different from believing. There's something particularly sacred about an atom or a molecule that came from the leather of the earliest manuscripts. You see what I mean? We believe in the wording. And it's very important to maintain that, because often people say, you evangelicals like the original manuscripts, but you don't have them. Oh no, the doctrine of Scripture falls apart. Now this is a one that gets a bit closer to home. It's the word Bible. I want to advise you that the word Bible is suboptimal in many situations. If you look in Reformed confessions, if you look in Reformation statements of faith, you will find them on the whole using the word Scripture. Scriptura, think in your own language of what are the older words that they were using, and you'll realize that the word Bible has become more common, really, even in the last 100 years. And when you study the history of this, it has a seeming long history, but there have been some changes. So the word Bible comes from the Greek word biblia, which is a plural. And biblia gives Latin biblia, which is a plural. But biblia plural in Latin, neuter plural, can easily become biblia feminine singular in Latin, and that's happened across a whole load of European languages. And it happens sometime between the 10th and the 13th century. So we are then left with languages which have, for their word for God's books, a singular word. In Anglo-Saxon, the word for Bible was bibliotheque, the library. There was a sense of plurality that God had given. Now, what then happens in English, once you have the word Bible, which you remember is a plural, but it's become a singular, they then put an S on the end to make it plural again, and you have Bibles, and I can make a pile of Bibles, right? But you realize by this stage it's drifted from its meaning of the collection of books. So when I look in the Oxford English Dictionary now, and I look at the word Bible, again, I realize it's multivalent. It's got meaning number one, which are the books of Holy Scripture. Meaning number two, and I'm paraphrasing, a physical copy of the books. Now, if the word Bible has got more than one meaning, then the word biblical has got more than one meaning. Any word you derive from it is going to have more than one sense. So when I say biblical inerrancy, I may mean meaning number one, God gave books and they're without error. Someone may think I mean meaning number two, physical objects with no error in them. You see how we can get into trouble? Now, if we stick with the word scripture, we don't have the same problem. Scriptura, Latin, means writing, and it comes into all sorts of other languages like that. Now, in American English, by my search of corpuses, you find that Americans use the word Bible 11 times more than the word scriptures. In British English, it's 6 times more. But if we go back several hundred years, the proportions were reversed. Now, one reason we like the word Bible is because it enables us to dialogue with non-Christians easily. Secularists love the word Bible. They love it because it allows them to say, okay, the Christians have got the Bible, and the Muslims have got the Quran, and other people have got their holy books. It domesticates what we're talking about. And we want to emphasize that God has given us words in books. Okay, we want to emphasize the library. We want to emphasize the plurality. We want to emphasize what God's given. I'm not saying you should not use the word Bible. I use the word Bible, and I will use it again in this talk. But I think you need to be careful about the word Bible, because it doesn't always do the work we want it to do. When a skeptic like Bart Ehrman attacks the scriptures, what he tends to do is attack using the word Bible, how the Bible has changed or something like this. And one of the things he believes is if we do not have a perfect physical copy of this thing, then the whole of the doctrine of scripture doesn't work. It's pointless. But think about it. Before there was any printing and people copied manuscripts, everyone knew that there was no perfect manuscript. Imagine having a conversation with Saint Augustine. He has his Latin manuscript of John in front of him. And you say to Saint Augustine, Saint Augustine, don't you know that when people copy things by hand, they make mistakes? Your Latin copy of John may have some mistakes in. He would say, well, yes, of course, it's copied by hand. Aha! So, St. Augustine, you are not allowed to conclude that God has spoken to us and given us the book of John. And he would say, well, that doesn't follow at all. Because he was able to distinguish in his mind between the doctrine that God spoke, God gave books, and the physical copy in front of him. Now, in English Bibles, we rarely have typographical errors. I know that in Bibles in other European languages, there are more commonly errors. I've seen them in French Bibles, Romanian Bibles, and others, that there are such things. So, but as typography improves, our expectation of higher and higher perfection in our printed text has improved, and that's why our tolerance for the making that distinction between God-giving words and the physical copy I have has been lessened. Another bad word is the word inspired. I mean, one of the problems about inspired, it's breathed into, and we might say that Mozart was inspired. So again, it's multivalent. Any word that has multiple meanings may be problematic because we speak it meaning one meaning other people understand it, meaning another. Now, the expression, of course, comes from 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, where it says, all scripture is God-breathed, meaning God breathed it out. God speaks the words of scripture out of his mouth. Now, we know God doesn't physically have a mouth. And we know that these words are used metaphorically for many reasons. One of the reasons, for instance, would be when it talks about the hand of God, it's always in the singular. So it's a pretty good clue that this is meant metaphorically, and so on. So God doesn't physically have a mouth, but the words attributed to him are so closely connected to him that we may imagine them and think of them and conceive of them as coming from his mouth without trying to visualize it, you understand. Okay. Another word we might use is autographs, the first written copies. But of course, again, we need to distinguish between the first written copies and the words on the copies. So I want to say we believe in the wording on the autograph. Some people say wording of the autograph, some people say wording in the autographs. I like the wording on the autographs because I think that makes most clear distinction. So when we're looking at the New Testament, what we're looking for is the original wording, that goes back to those whom Christ commissioned with his authority. Some of these were of the 12 apostles, some of them were not. But even those who were not, Mark, Luke, the writer to the Hebrews, are people who are trusted by the apostles whom Christ himself trusted. So in other words, Christ commissioned this group as a whole to be competent to get the message about him out. You can't say, I trust Christ, but I don't trust his selection of group to convey him to others. So we're really looking at the apostolic wording. With the Old Testament, it's more complex because we're looking not just at what is the final text, but that final text may have come through a long time. For instance, the books of Kings, the books of Chronicles, may have been written over many centuries by different prophets, and there may be a school of history writers. We don't know. And so that means that God may have been upholding the truth of their record writing over a long period of time. But then what we're interested in is the wording which is finalized and then at the origin of the copying process to us, and its authority is recognized by God's chosen people of Israel. So in other words, it's the and this is relevant to what book should we have in the Old Testament. There's no better group to agree with on the subject of what books to have in the Old Testament than God's people Israel. Now, in the title, I had the word, how can we know the exact words of Scripture? And we got to think about this word know for a minute, because the word know has changed its meaning in the last 200 years. So many people in the past would talk about knowing things, and they would understand that God upheld knowing. So God makes it so that our language works, God works it so that our knowing works. But then along comes skepticism and says, how do we know anything at all? Descartes starts with, I think, therefore I exist. Hume has this idea of you build up gradually, David Hume, from knowing very little, and you gradually infer more and more, and you'll get more and more confident in your belief by repetition. And then what people believe nowadays sometimes is that when we use the word know, it's really as a shortcut for very high levels of belief and confidence. So when you get to 99% or 99.5%, belief, confident belief, you then, as a shortcut, say, I know. Okay? And of course, on that definition, you never really know anything. I mean, because after all, you could be in the middle of the Truman Show now, you could be in the middle of the Matrix, and you're looking at all of these things that you think you know, but really it's just people stimulating electrodes on your mind and making you perceive things. Okay? So you never really know. Now, I think this is a wrong definition of no. It's also an unhelpful definition for the word no. You may as well not even have the word if you're going to use that. So I use it in the way that Alvin Plantinga defined, which is warranted true belief. This is true belief which has adequate grounds, adequate evidence and reason to believe it. And so warranted true belief. And of course, what that means is there are all sorts of things we can know in life generally because they're true and because we have got grounds to believe them. And those grounds can be upheld by God himself. We believe that there is a God, and there are often things we don't know how they work, but we know that they do work. So we don't know how consciousness works, but we know it does work. We don't know how language works. We can't fully describe how language works, but we know that it does work. We don't know how life works, but we know it does work. You see? I mean, we know bits of how life works once life's arrived, but how, you know, what makes something alive or not? I mean, you know, there are all sorts of things we don't know. And I think we can say the same with knowing. We don't have to know how knowing works to know things. Think of a young child. What is their epistemology? How do they know how knowing works? You know, they have to be able to describe that before they can know their mother. This is an absurd idea. Of course you can know things without knowing how you know. Now, this doesn't mean it's all irrational, but it does mean we have a benevolent God upholding knowing. So therefore, for us, knowing that we have the right words of the true words of God depends on one, it being true, and two, there being warrant. Now, let's think about this. Imagine an analog clock which has stopped. You know, these older types of clock, and they stopped, but it's a 12-hour clock, so twice a day it's correct. Okay? And so you look at it twice a day, and you happen to look at it at the right time, and you say, aha, because of the clock, I know it is this time. Unfortunately, that is not knowing, because that's not proper warrant for your belief. Okay? So it's true belief, but it's not warranted true belief. So in order for it to be warrant, it has to be something that's based on a correct foundation. Now, you could know something because someone who is a true witness told you. So for instance, my parents were Christian believers, and they told me about God, and they told me about Jesus. And because that's true, and they told me, and then actually that is warranted. Yeah, it's warranted true belief. It's knowledge. Now, this is where we can dig down on what constitutes warrant. But there are all sorts of things that we believe for adequate reasons. They aren't necessarily things that we can prove. For instance, we cannot prove that we are not a brain in a vat of chemicals being stimulated by electrodes. But it's perfectly rational for us to believe that we're not. You see? So, in other words, there are all sorts of things we may not be able to prove which are normal. I mean, you can't prove that everyone wasn't created 5 seconds ago with their memories, right? Can't disprove it, but there's no reason to suppose it. So what we're saying is, at this point, are our minds working correctly? So knowing, one of the things we've seen happen with text of the Bible, and here I'm using the word text, oh dear, get out of the habit, is that we've moved from presuming something's original to presuming it's not original until you prove it's original. So someone like Matthew Henry might write a commentary and would say, in the Hebrew original it says, and he presumes that his late Hebrew manuscripts have what was originally given, unless someone has some very good evidence against it. And what happens is, of course, as people discover earlier and earlier manuscripts, you realize how correct Matthew Henry was to do that. We may also have legitimate disprovable presumptions. Someone could make a perfect fake banana. Okay, they make it looks very, very good close up, even when you hold it. But it's not a banana; it's a fake. Okay, and I look at it and I say that's a banana. Now, actually, I'm wrong. It's not a banana; it's a fake. But I've got a disprovable presumption. I've got a legitimate disprovable presumption. You can also have that. So I might believe that the text, the earliest wording, is one set of wording, and then an earlier manuscript might be discovered. And I then say, well, okay, I was following the right thing at the time, but actually I'm now revising my belief in the light of this newer evidence. But another way we can look at this is that if God is speaking in Scripture, then this is God's voice, and God's voice can be directly recognized. So Jesus says, "My sheep hear my voice." God often in Scripture portrays himself as speaking directly to people. Now, in a materialist world, the way they believe it works is that my mind and ability to speak are emergent properties from my physical self. And let's say I want to speak to someone, say Andy at the back, he's very, very back. And what happens is it's not that I sort of recognize him, but that he's made of chemicals, and somehow the emergent property that arises from my chemicals recognizes the emergent property that arises from his chemicals, and somehow an illusion of communication might go on, perhaps real communication, but it all arises out of the physical. And that's an incredibly complicated and unnecessarily complicated view of just saying one person directly recognizes another person. You know, so we've actually got a far simpler view of this. And so we can say voice can be directly heard and God's voice can be directly recognized. Now, I want to say, in addition, when we look at Scripture, a lot of people get into the who wrote this book, and they like to get that, which is very important, but they get down into the individual styles. And the way many people would like to study Scripture is you study Johannine style, that's good, and you study Matthean style, and you study Isaianic style, and you build up what you're going to say that they all say, and then you synthesize it together. There's something very good about that. But often what people do is they like to say, we look at what the human meant, and from that we try and work out what God meant, right? See? So you've got the human meaning, which is the primary meaning, and then the God meaning, which is the secondary meaning. And I say, no. God's meaning is the primary meaning, the human meaning is the secondary meaning. And I would want to say we can be more scientifically confident of God's meaning than we can about the human meaning. Let me explain. If we have 66 books of God's writing style and only one of Matthew's writing style, then we have a bigger sample of God's style than of his. So even from a grammatical point of view, and I know there are different sorts of grammar in the different books, we can be more confident about God's style than about Matthew's, or even about God's intention than Matthew's. The question of what Isaiah meant is interesting. But it's not an overriding question, because after all, in 1 Peter, it says that the prophets were wondering what the Spirit of Christ in them meant. So in fact, I'm looking at that bigger meaning. I'm very interested in breaking things down and analyzing them. So of course, I'm going to look at how the style of one book differs from the style of another book. But I don't give that primacy in the way I look at things, and when I'm trying to work out what things mean, sometimes the piece is bigger than the whole. Think of an orchestral piece. There's the significance to what the violin does, and the first violin, and so on, and you can analyze it, and you have a score which will give you just the line that the first violin does, and just the bit that the trombone does, and so on. That's very interesting. But you also want the conductor's score, in which you have the whole. Now, how can we argue for textual reliability? There are many different sorts of manuscript. When we talk about manuscript, that word manuscript is not a clear word. Manuscript means written by hand. Anything written by hand is a manuscript. We still write manuscripts today. I can see someone, two people producing manuscripts right now. And keep writing your manuscripts, and they're very, very good. I mean, by the way, this is interesting that when you get a new technology like printing, it doesn't get rid of manuscripts, it just displaces them partly. When you get computer and IT, again, it displaces print partly, but the print stays on as well. So you just add new technology. So here we have, you could write on stone or pottery, you could write Bible by hand, and it would be a manuscript, but usually not counted as one. Because what we like to do when we talk about manuscripts is usually talk about papyrus here. Oh, no, that's not the one either. I'm going to be careful with this. Papyrus and leather. But you could have a manuscript that is this size, or a manuscript that is this size and has 400, 500 pages. You can have a manuscript which is a continuous text, or as many, many manuscripts are, you can have extracts. You think about the cost of writing out a Bible. If it's a year to write out a Bible, and that's a minimum, then it's a very expensive thing. It's about 200-300 animal skins. Again, very expensive. By the way, that's one very good reason to think that Bibles don't get forged in large numbers. Think about the expense of forging manuscripts. If you're writing on leather, it's incredibly expensive. So what often you have with church services is you have just the manuscript with the readings for the church services. It's called a lectionary. Now, one argument that's been used for the reliability of the New Testament goes like this. It's by F.F. Bruce, and it's a good argument. It goes like this. Classical scholars accept the authenticity of all sorts of classical works which have fewer manuscripts than the New Testament. So that's something you can attest. Now, don't just use his writings from 50, 60 years ago, because many, many more manuscripts have been discovered since then. And also, he chose a few examples. There are some, like Homer, where there are many more manuscripts, some which there are fewer. But basically, this is sound. If you accept that, he can then say, well, New Testament manuscripts are earlier and more numerous. Therefore, if you accept one, it's reasonable for you to accept two. Now, notice, this is an argument from consistency. It's saying you already accept something. Therefore, by consistency, you ought to accept the other thing. Now, some people pervert this argument by simplifying it, and they try to make it work without the first step. And that is, you don't have the person already accepting something, you see? And so what they say is, the New Testament has more manuscripts than any other work, therefore it should be accepted as authentic. And this is a fallacious argument. And it's a very, very bad argument. And there are all sorts of problems with it. For instance, the day after John's Gospel was written, let's say in Ephesus, there was probably only one copy of it. Imagine the Apostle John going out and saying, you should accept this because there are more copies of it than any other book in the world. People would have looked at him and said, well, how stupid can you be? You don't need lots of copies. You know, imagine Hilkiah finding the book of the law in the temple, bringing it to Josiah, who says, go back, unless you can find at least 10 copies, I'm not listening. This is absurd. You only need one copy. One copy is enough. Now, I'd want to say that as far as copies of the New Testament or the Old Testament are concerned, we have enough copies and more. Okay, enough and more. What I don't need to do is prove that we have the most. Now, it is true that there are more manuscript copies of the New Testament than there are of classical works. There are about 5,500 manuscripts of the New Testament. There are also about 5,500 manuscripts of John Chrysostom. Now, of course, John Chrysostom was a Christian father quoting lots of the Bible. So we could add that as more evidence for the New Testament. But the point is, you know, what gets produced in multiple copies can depend on all sorts of things. You know, there may be huge numbers of a particular best-selling book at a particular time. Just be very careful about using this, because this thing can be surpassed. In China, for many years, there were more copies of Mao's Little Red Book, you see? So in terms of the superlatives, you need to be careful. But also, it doesn't work logically. There is no connection between multiple copies and truthfulness. I mean, there are lots of copies of yesterday's USA Today. There are more copies of probably, you know, the local Polish newspaper than there are manuscripts of the New Testament. Does that mean the local Polish newspaper is somehow more from God, more correct, and so on? It doesn't make sense. So we have lots of copies, we have enough copies, but the argument, as F.F. Bruce set it out, was correct because it was an argument from consistency, and this is the sort of argument Jesus uses. So Jesus, very often when he's asked a question, says, well, why do you do this? In other words, he turns the question back and he asks people to look at the consistency, because consistency and inconsistency is one of the quickest ways of showing people's true heart, their true intention. And we see this so much in politics, don't we, where one side doesn't like a particular way of voting until it suits them to get through what they want. And this is happening, plenty of it in Britain, but it happens in all sorts of countries at all sorts of times. And it's a very interesting way, because when you do that, you show what your heart really is. Okay, so we've looked at some problems there. So one way we could argue for the reliability of the Bible is from vindicated trust. For instance, we can say all of these people, Huss, Calvin, and so on, trusted that they had good scripture, and they did so before there was any archaeology, because archaeology really begins with Napoleon Bonaparte around 1798. So we could say there have been 17 centuries of martyrs, people suffering for the Christian faith, confident in the integrities of scripture. If we ask any Christian from the 1700s or 1600s, and we ask them a question like, can you tell me the name of the Assyrian king who surrounded Jerusalem? They will say, well, they might look in their Bible, and they might search their memory, but they say Sennacherib. You can ask them all sorts of other things. And actually, it turns out to be correct. I mean, I like to do this one. If you think of the enemies of the Israelites in order in the Old Testament, you basically say, well, the sort of earliest enemies tend to be the Amorites. Yeah, they get mentioned a lot at that early stage. Then you get the Philistines. Then you get the Assyrians. Then after them, you get the Babylonians. And then after them, you get the Persians. But isn't it an amazing thing that is what you would say, a basic answer you would have got from someone 250 years ago before there was any archaeology? Then people dig things out of the ground and they discover all those cultures and they discover them in that order. That's a rather remarkable thing. So here we have a bit of the old King James Version from 2 Kings chapter 18 and verse 13. And it's 1611. And we're just going to read it. So we like to go to older English and slightly odd print. Now remember, for many of us, how many Finns do we have here? Finns or Estonians? Okay, one. So probably all of the rest of us are speaking Indo-European, is that right? So everyone else speaking an Indo-European language. Now the great thing about Indo-European languages, I forgot about Hungarians, yeah. Many Hungarians. How many Hungarians do we have? Bless you. There are some of our loan words in your language. Thank you very much. Probably all of the rest of us are speaking some sort of Indo-European. And as you go back in time, they get closer, which is really good. So this is why reading older English is going to be easier than reading modern English, isn't it? Maybe not. Okay, so here we go. Now, in the 14th year of King Hezekiah, did Sennacherib, king of Assyria, Assyria, come up against all the fenced cities, that means walled cities of Judah, and took them. And Hezekiah, king of Judah, sent to the king of Assyria, to Lachish, saying, I have offended, I've done something wrong. Return from me, that means please go away. That which thou puttest on me will I bear, which means whatever you tell me I have to pay, I will pay. And the king of Assyria appointed unto Hezekiah, king of Judah, 300 talents of silver and 30 talents of gold. That's not that he gave it. He said, this is the fine, dude. Okay? And Hezekiah gave him all the silver that was found in the house of the Lord and in the treasures of the king's house. Now, I hope you notice a few things about this 400-year-old English. Firstly, it's in a 24-letter alphabet, not a 26-letter alphabet. That is, the letter I and the letter J are just the same, and the letter U and the letter V are just the same. So when people say it's the KJV, remember there was no J and there was no V at the time. More to the point, there's also no apostrophe. Wonderful, back in the days before the apostrophe as well. Horrible things that people have invented since then. Part of the general corruption of sin. Now, what we see here is if we were to try and dig out the facts here, we'd say, well, it's telling us that there's a Judean king called Hezekiah. All the fortified cities of Judah were captured, except for Jerusalem. That's in the wider context. This was done by Sennacherib, king of Assyria. Sennacherib particularly fought against Lachish. Again, that's in the surrounding context. Hezekiah was fined 30 talents of silver, of gold, sorry, and 300 talents of silver. And then this is the strange bit. Having been found 300 talents of silver, he gave him all of the silver that was in the king's house, the palace, and in the temple. Okay, God's house. And you wonder, well, was that coincidentally just exactly 300? Well, this is then archaeology begins. And you remember that the French beat the English to decipher Egyptian. So in 1822, Champollion deciphers Egyptian. Then in the 1840s and 50s, people decipher Old Persian and Akkadian. And as they decipher Akkadian, they then find Sennacherib's own records of this attack on Jerusalem. And this is what he says. As for Hezekiah the Judean, I besieged 46 of his fortified walled cities. Now that phrase is very similar, isn't it? The walled cities. I conquered them and took out 200,150 people. Now, this is when we see some political spin, because he didn't actually capture Jerusalem. So how can you put positively, I didn't capture Jerusalem? If you're not allowed to lose, this is what you do. He himself, I locked up within Jerusalem, his royal city, like a bird in a cage. I mean, this is a very positive spin on, but you didn't get into the cage, did you? No. Hezekiah was overwhelmed by the splendor of my lordliness. And he sent me 30 talents of gold, 800 talents of silver. Wow. Well, I find this absolutely fascinating. And you can see, how many talents of gold was it in the Bible? 30. And how many talents of silver in the Bible? 300. And how much did he actually pay? All the silver that was in the palace and in the temple. Now, I find the agreement on the amount of gold more interesting or more fascinating than the difference in the amount of silver, number of talents. Because I do not know of any ancient story, be it Herodotus, Aesop, Homer, the Quran, where you have something so precisely mentioned, handed down in manuscripts over time, and then something is deciphered and it turns up and says exactly the same. This is astounding, particularly because numbers are so easily changed. If you miscopy a number, you know, it's very hard to correct that. Now, when the King James Version was made, the earliest manuscripts they had in Hebrew were from the 11th century. So you think about this. This event is 700 BC. That's 700 years to BC, plus 1100 years of AD, 1800 years in total. And that number has been correctly handed down by scribe after scribe. If one scribe had got it wrong, it wouldn't have got through correctly. It's a phenomenal thing. Then we have the difference in silver. Now, of course, there are various possibilities. If you just have two texts, you could have text A and text B, and it could be that A is wrong, B is wrong, A and B somehow fit together, or they're both wrong. Okay, so you can, those are your permutations. Now, of course, I believe in the scriptures, and so scripture's right, but I'd say I can actually have both of these, because I think that it's very difficult when you're being besieged by someone, by the way, because if you pay them, what guarantee do you have they're going to withdraw at all? Now, there are different orders, people can read the events, but one option is actually to have all of this happening together. Now, that's an argument for the he actually sent all of 800, he was fine, told 300, and he for some reason was scared and sent more. Now, of course, that can't have been before the after the Assyrian soldiers had been killed. This is the opening of John's Gospel in Erasmus's 1516 Greek New Testament. So here we can see a nice big letter E. You see that letter E, and then N. N, arche, in beginning, N, ho, logos. That's an os. Okay, so in the beginning was the word, and this is an and, kai, ho, logos, and the word, en, pros, that's a ton, theon. And the word was with God, and the word was God, and so on. Now, the great thing about this is you can read every letter. You just need to get your eye attuned to it. I mean, even if you've not done Greek, you can read it, learn to read it quite quickly. It's John 1 as we all know it. But the earliest manuscripts that he had when he printed that edition in 1516 were 12th century manuscripts. And now we have manuscripts that are a lot earlier. This is a manuscript of the end of Luke and beginning of John from probably the early 3rd century. We can go in. And so here we have N, So the A isn't as big, but it's still the same letter. En arche, en ho logos, etc. You get the idea. Now, this is an amazing thing. We can go back even earlier. Here's another manuscript, maybe the year 200. En arche, en ho logos. Okay, this is how it begins. In the beginning was the word. And you can search it out, and you can find, here's a word, phos for photosynthesis, Zoe, life. In him was life, and the life was light of men. Zoe means life. You can just find it all. It's all just beautiful. And you can learn to read it really quite quickly. I mean, here's the word name, actually. That's nice. N, well, it's got, forget the O at the beginning, which is part of the name. N-O-M, nom. Yeah? As in onoma. Okay, it's the word for name. So it's, you see, it's all there. I mean, it even looks like it's there. Now, we then did an edition of the Greek New Testament at Tinder House, and this is my beautiful daughter. I like to show. She doesn't like to be shown, but you know, she does give me permission. And somewhere, no, I didn't bring it with me. We produced the Greek New Testament. Here we have the oldest bookshop in the English-speaking world, and in its windows we have the Tinder House Greek New Testament, published by Crossway and Cambridge University Press. Nice thing we found out when we had edited the opening of John is that we had exactly the same 188 words in a row, or 812 letters in a row, as Erasmus has had 500 years earlier. In fact, when we looked at our edition, and the German Bible Society edition, and the Majority Text edition, and the Secular Society of Biblical Literature edition, and our own edition, they all had the same 812 letters in a row at the opening of John. I say, aha, you've just given me a good example. I bet that it doesn't all work as well as that. Okay, that's true, that's fine. So here we have Erasmus is not just his commentary on the New, or his edition of the New Testament. Now we have his actual annotations. And this is where he wrote what he thought. And this is really interesting because we're going to go to John chapter 8. Now remember John chapter 8, you have this passage about the woman caught in adultery, and most of the modern Bibles will say it's not part of the original text, as they might call it, or I don't know what they call it in the footnotes. So we're going to read a bit of Latin. How many of you have done a bit of Latin? Great, we'll be fine. So here we've got a big letter A and a D. Adducunt, they led, however they led, who led? The scribi et pharisai. The scribes and Pharisees led a mulierem, a woman. Thank you. Now then you have a close bracket because that is setting apart the biblical text before the bit that he comments on. Okay, so he's now going to go into the comment. And so this is the way they would do it. So there's another one of those brackets where they each return to the house and it comments on that. Okay, now, historia, which means the story, de muliere adultera, about the adulterous woman, non habetur, anyone want to translate for me?
Was not in it?
Yeah, is not contained in plerisque Graecis exemplaribus. Anyone want to translate that for me? Yeah, in the Greek manuscripts, that's Graecis exemplaribus. What about this plerisque?
Many.
Many is actually the majority. Okay? So he's saying that that's the case. In nonullis, which means in not a few. Adjecta erat, it was put in calce at the bottom, you know, or in the margin. So what we see here, and Chrysostom makes no mention of this. Okay, so hopefully you can follow a certain amount. Now, the point is this. This is Erasmus, without the early manuscripts we have now, already knows there's some questions about that passage. So why does he put it in? Well, one of the reasons he puts it in is because he is a Catholic. And in 1516, he does not want to make a break with the Catholic Church. He's trying to produce an edition which lines up as much as possible with the Latin Bible. And so he does this. Now, I am giving you one particular take on this passage. There are many wonderful evangelical Christians, including some great scholars, who will disagree with me, okay? But I will give you how I put things together. And the way I put it together is this. At the Reformation, there was a reform on the subject, the doctrine of salvation. But people didn't reform everything. For instance, I mean, a lot of reformers still kept printing apocryphas in their Bible for a little bit, you know, about 50 years, 100 years. They still kept wearing robes and so on, which you could say don't have much warrant in the New Testament, although some of you may wear robes and that's fine, bless you. I've done it once when I was given short notice and was a bit surprised. But anyway, it's I think it's okay, very forgivable. Sorry, if you are, how many, anyone want to admit to being a robe wearer? Fine. I mean, there's as much reason for wearing long flowing things from the Bible as jeans. So, but the point is this, I think we could argue that on the eve of the Reformation, 1516, when Erasmus comes out with his text, the problem with it is it's good enough. So when the reformers want to have a dialogue with the Catholics, do they want to be debating everything at once? Or do they rather want to be narrowing their debate to the things that really matter? The doctrine of salvation and the doctrine of the church and questions of authority. Those are the things they really want to do on. And so they want to have a ground that they can discuss together. And so that is why a passage like this is kept on. But what I want to say is the really good thing is this. There are only two passages of length in the Gospels or in the New Testament, entire New Testament, where there are any such questions. One is the woman caught in adultery. The other is the end of Mark. And over the last 500 years, no new passages have turned up of this kind as people have discovered more manuscripts. And the thing is, these weren't a surprise because if you read the history of the church fathers were discussing these things. People knew about them. So there is no surprise. You know, it's not that actually there's a massive amount of uncertainty about the text of the New Testament. I would say if you are following Protestant principles of trying to use the earliest text you can in a careful way, then you will end up, whatever method you apply, with some pretty similar editions of the New Testament in Greek. Looking at Erasmus, I'd say Erasmus knew about 77% of the verses in the Textus Receptus. He knew that there were questions about those. This is what became the basis for the Reformation translations in all the European languages. Remember, of course, that Czech and French and all sorts of languages have complete translations before English gets one because, you know, English was a far less important language back then. I would argue that if he were willing to break with the Vulgate, he could have got far closer to the modern text. Okay, I've said that one. So what do you do when manuscripts disagree? Well, one thing you can do is you can look at things positively. It's like in life, there are people you trust, there are people you don't trust, and you can look at this with manuscripts. You can have really scruffy manuscripts where someone's got multiple levels of correction on and they don't seem to be taking much care, and they also differ from all of the other manuscripts. I mean, a bit like when you have a number of witnesses to an event, one of them is completely different from all the other ones. Well, you're not going to trust that so much. And so what you can do also is you could look at eliminating bad witness. Now, there are certain mistakes that regularly get made. For instance, when two things begin with the same beginning, or a word begins the same and ends the same, sometimes you substitute a word. There are all sorts of things that can go on as a scribe is thinking and copying out, because often you have to vocalize the word in your head before you put it down. And one of the things this does is often it produces unimportant variation. So you can say Jesus as the Jesus or simply Jesus, but it doesn't make a difference to who you're talking about. You can say he said to them or to them he said. Again, it doesn't make a difference at that sort of level. But even then, the great thing is, with the evidence that we have, we're able to get more and more and more precise about the words of the New Testament. But at the end of the day, our job as editors or translators or whatever we are, is not to produce something any better than we have already received. Our job is like a scribe. A scribe is not supposed to look at the manuscript he's copying from and think, I don't like that, I'm going to write something better. As an editor, my job is to look at the very best manuscript we can and to pass on what we judge to be best for people. But to remember, we are only editors. And that's very important and very liberating. So one of the things we decided is we would only print something which had at least two manuscripts
in support of it and had at least one early manuscript in support of it. Now, why would we make a rule like that? We made a rule like that to constrain our fallibility in our sinfulness. So we wanted to take some of those decisions out of our hands, and that was a helpful thing. Now, one thing that some people believe is that you have to have all of the Bible in order to have any of the Bible, if you see what I mean. And this is the way sometimes Bart Ehrman would argue. It's as if you need to have all the verbal sequences that God gave in order to for it to work. It's a bit like in, you know, Harry Potter, where you get, you know, if you say the magic spell wrong, let's say you say diagonally when you're meant to say Diagon Alley, you end up in the wrong place. This is the sort of thing. In a magic spell, if you mispronounce one syllable, it doesn't work. Similarly, in some recitation of the Quran, it's invalidated if you mispronounce one syllable. Now, do we believe that if the book of Proverbs is translated into a Papua New Guinean language, that it is unable to work if they don't also have the book of John? No. We believe that that book works on its own. In fact, what we can't say is because there's one bit of a speech we didn't hear, we're going to ignore everything. Imagine your mother calls you for a meal or whatever it is, you know, when you're a child. You can't say, well, there was a word in that very long sentence I wasn't quite sure about, so I stayed in my room. You know, this is not a good excuse. So our uncertainty about one particular word, our uncertainty about the meaning of a word, is not an excuse for lack of obedience. So this is where we've got to realize that when God speaks, he speaks with moral compulsion. He calls us, we have to obey. And any analogy that tries to make an excuse because you're uncertain about one bit is unhelpful. I want to give you two analogies. Some people, when they think of the doctrine of Scripture, they think of it as like the Burj Al Khalifa, something very tall. And, you know, it basically everything stands on top of one thing. And so they have some belief. And if you shake that, the whole tower shakes. I would want to say your doctrine of Scripture should be more like a spider's web, or in American English, spider web. Okay? Because what happens is a spider's web can be attached to a corner of the room by many different nodes, many different bits of stickiness. And there are so many grounds for believing the Scriptures that you don't need everything to be depending on one of those nodes. You can actually have it's much better to have multiple reasons for believing the Scriptures, such as the resurrection, my mother told me, prophecy. I mean, these are all good reasons, you know. So archaeology, you go on, you know, the gospel, the transforming power of the gospel. Who could ever make up a story of like this? Supremely, the person of Jesus. I mean, you just go on, all the reasons you have to believe, and it's important to have that widespread. The other thing when it comes to the integrity of Scripture, and I'm sorry about this analogy, but someone's given it to you, me. Muslim once said to a Christian, if you had a glass of water with one drop of urine in, would you drink it? And the answer is usually no, unless you're desperate of thirst. And that was their analogy. It's as if Scripture is somehow, you know, easily corrupted, and if there's one bit wrong, it doesn't work, like the magic spell. And I would say a better analogy for Scripture is uranium. You don't say because your uranium is not 100% enriched, nothing is going to happen. It's an extremely powerful thing. The Word of God is so powerful that in a bad Jehovah's Witness translation or a bad medieval Latin translation, there's still so much of the indestructible Word of God that it's life-changing. And that's important to recognize that in terms of how these things work. So that means we can focus on what we're certain about. Now, one of the things that happens about the way the evidence for the New Testament comes, a funny thing is that as the gap between our earliest manuscripts and the time of the New Testament has got smaller, doubts in the West have got bigger. So we see, in fact, that gap is never going to completely close. I said to another group the other day imagine you had had, Moses coming down the mountain, you know, with the tablets, and someone had photographed that, you know, you wouldn't prove that it hadn't been changed just before he came around the corner. So this, you can never completely narrow that gap, but we can say there's basically an inverse relationship between the amount of of data, the amount of evidence, and people's confidence in the scriptures. And this is a very interesting thing to notice going on. Now let's get back to the Old Testament text for a little bit of time. The way many people view the Old Testament text is they say, well, okay, I accept that in the medieval ages, Middle Ages, Jews were incredibly careful about how they copied. Okay, get that. But then they say, but before the year 70, when the temple was destroyed, actually there's plenty of evidence for more varied copying. And there's a level of truth to this. In the Dead Sea Scrolls, there are some very copies that are very close to the ones 1,000 years later, and there are some that are a bit more varied. They'd also say there were variant Greek forms, and that these can be earlier than the Hebrew. And people would say that the New Testament writers use something called the Septuagint, and that's what they were quoting. And there's so much truth in a lot of this. And so they say, well, there's basically a problem with the evangelical doctrine of Scripture, namely that the text of the Old Testament was not fixed at the time of Jesus. So therefore, the argument that evangelicals like to use, that Jesus quoted the Old Testament, he therefore gives it his authority, it doesn't work if the Old Testament's still changing after Jesus, you see? So that's an argument, and there are many layers of technicality into this. I'm just going to touch on how I deal with this. So I'd want to say that the Old Testament books were fixed by the time of Jesus. I'd want to say that the evidence that there's a they start fixing things after the year 70 and not before is exaggerated. I want to say that already by the first century BC, there's a type of translation into Greek, which is a revised translation into Greek, often called the Kaige version. That's K-A-I-G-E. You can look up that word. The Kaige, it's not a complete copy of the Old Testament, but it's parts of it, showing that they are really concerned to be super literal. And that's already going on. And their aim is to get closer to the Palestinian Hebrew copy. And in fact, the Jews are incredibly dissatisfied with the earliest Greek that's made. And how do we know that? Because they did lots more translations. There's a guy called Aquila, Symmachus, Theodotion. You can look them up. They all made translations of the Old Testament into Greek. I also want to say that although we often talk about the word Septuagint today, it's a bit of a confusing word. Because really, there was a story about 72 translators just having done the first five books of the Old Testament. And they were always referred to as 72 plus a noun, 72 translators, 72 elders. Then that changed to 70, to simplify it. After a while, they decided to drop the noun and just talk about the 70, not the 70 elders or 70 translators. Then they decided, rather than talking about the 70 as a translation, as translators, they talk about 70 as a translation. And finally, 70 became a singular. So we now say the Septuagint is in English, not the Septuagint are. Likewise, the books extended from first, just the first five books of the Bible, then the whole Old Testament, then we find people add apocryphal books, then they add apocryphal books that aren't even translated, they were written in Greek originally, and now if you buy a Septuagint today, it will have those books in, and there are even some bits of the New Testament in the Septuagint, bits from Luke, which you can buy in a copy today. So it's expanded more and more. And we can see how this happens in various European languages, where over time the plural has switched to a singular. So I've written about this if you want to know. So just watch out for that. And so my argument is basically this. There's no reason for us to think that when Paul used a Greek version of Isaiah, he thought it was made by the same people who's made the Greek version of the Pentateuch, the first five books. There's no reason to think there was a singular translation into Greek. It's more complex. If you want to get into it, get into complexities, but don't say because one person in the New Testament quotes this Greek version, therefore every bit is validated like that. The other thing is, when you're looking at the books of the Old Testament, we don't differ as Protestants from two very prominent Catholics at the time of the Reformation. Cardinal Jimenez was the guy in charge of the Spanish Inquisition, so obviously in Spain, at the time of the Reformation, and he did this multi-volume polyglot Bible. I'm sorry to have some more Latin, but well, it's good fun, isn't it? And this is what he says. He has his Latin multi-volume thing, and he says this, "But indeed, books outside the canon, which the church, rather for edification of the people than for authority of establishing, I have to jump to that word now, ecclesiastical dogma. The church has received these. So these books which it's received only have Greek scripture, Greek writing. Now, the point is this. He's saying all sorts of bits of things that are now in the Catholic Apocrypha should not be used for establishing doctrine. Okay, so this is a guy basically writing the same year that Luther writes his theses. And what happens is in the Council of Trent, the Catholic Church digs its heels in, thank you, and says, we're going to say the Apocrypha is just as important as the rest. And he's not the only person of that. And he actually dedicates this book to the Pope. It gets an imprimatur from the Pope. So, you know, this was not heretical within Catholicism at the time. And as you look at it, it will talk about, for Joshua, the book of Joshua, it will call it the LXX, the 70. But actually for other books, there we got the book of Maccabees. It won't call it the book of the 70. You see? There's no 70 up there. I'm going to skip over that. Now, do you want to do Bart Ehrman? Or, yeah, I'll do a bit of Bart Ehrman. So Bart Ehrman, when he aims at the New Testament text, he has this wonderful quotation. This is how one of the things he says he lost his faith over. I kept reverting to my basic question. How does it help to say that the Bible is the inerrant word of God if in fact we don't have the words that God inherently inspired, but only the words copied by scribes? Now this is fascinating because, of course, if someone actually copies a word, it is the same word. You know, we don't have the words, but only the words copied by scribes. Like, sometimes correctly, but sometimes, many times, incorrectly. Well, how many times? What is the good to say that the autographs, i.e. the originals, were inspired? Sorry about the wording we're using. We don't have the originals. We have only error-ridden copies, and the vast majority of these are centuries removed from the originals and different from them, evidently in thousands of ways. Well, I mean, yes, but you have 2.6 pages, million pages of manuscripts, so I'm not sure how that really matters. So anyway, so look at this first question. Well, of course, if you say we don't have the original, I want to say, who says we don't? Can you prove we don't? Are you proving anywhere that we've lost anything? I don't think we've lost anything from the New Testament. You know, no one's demonstrated to me we've lost any part of the New Testament. So who says we don't have what God's inspired? So you're saying that, but and even if we don't, the doctrine of Scripture doesn't depend on the availability to us at every moment of everything, any more than the book of the law was uninspired the day before it was found by Hilkiah. But we only have words that are copied. Well, they're then the same words. They don't get less inspired by being copied. Many miscopyings don't destroy the words. Actually, miscopying just simply replicates something else. The words are still there. I mean, you don't copy a manuscript and destroy the one you copied from. So he said, what's good it's to say that the autographs were inspired. We don't have the originals. I want to say sorry. We've been using unclear terminology. I'm very sorry about that. We have only error-ridden copies. But Augustine was aware of that. So still believed in complete scriptural truthfulness. Many of these are removed by centuries. Well, yeah. Christians have been aware of that over the years. I mean, imagine going to John Wycliffe, Jan Hus, and saying, are you aware that, you know, the manuscript copies we have are from centuries later, at which point he says, I'm going to give up on my faith. I mean, I'm not going to die for that. You mean the manuscripts come from hundreds of years later? But you could go to a young Christian today, you know, and say, you know, the copies only come from hundreds of years later. And they go, ooh, you know. So why is it that Jan Hus would say, well, yeah. And the person today would go, you know, what psychologically has changed? You know, because the evidence is actually better than in the days of Hus. So, you know, so it's there's something about the way we are taking this doctrine on and appropriating it. We're not quite getting the way it works. Copies from loads later. Wow, how carefully God can ensure a copying process over a long period of time.